the book of Luke, chapter 19. I've been chomping at the bit all week to preach today. Been working on this message this week, and I know I've heard from heaven. And I pray you do too. I don't want you to hear what I have to say. I want you to hear what God wants to reveal. Because he doesn't just want to talk. He wants to communicate. You see, sometimes when we talk, we think we communicate, but we really don't communicate what we ought to communicate. We're just making noise. God doesn't want to just make noise. He wants to deliver a word. He wants to deliver a message that will change you, transform you, and never allow you to stay the same. Now, I want you to open your heart, not just your ears. I want you to allow God in. Get past the preacher and get to the master that we serve. Amen? Amen? I want to begin at verse 41 and read through verse 44 of the 19th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. Don't miss your God moment.
Hallelujah.
Amen? Don't miss your God moment. When he was come near, he beheld the city, he wept over it, saying, if thou hadst known, even now, at least in this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, now they are hid from thine eyes. For the day shall come upon thee, that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee, and compass thee around, and keep thee in on every side, and shall lay thee even with the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another. And here is where I'm drawing my text. Because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. Because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. Father, this morning, how we depend and rely completely and totally upon your Holy Ghost. Father, Lord, we're so inadequate and we're so inept. Without you, Lord, we do nothing. But I'm asking, Lord, that you would not only prepare the preacher, but you'd prepare the hearer. I pray, God, the soil would be ripe to receive the seed that's sown. I pray today, God, that, Lord, we would pay attention to you. Lord, you've got us where you want us to have your way with us. God, may we yield and surrender as we sang earlier in this service. May we allow you to be God. Father, may we not try to run the show and hold the reins, but God, may we relinquish to you what only you can use to direct our steps. God, tug us in the direction we need to go. Put us in the place we need to be. Lord, humble our hearts before you, God, so that, Lord, we can hear your voice. Lord, your will be done as our hearts cry. I need you as I preach. The congregation needs you as they listen. And God, I pray you would communicate the message that you want us to receive. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The days of God's visitations are simply supernatural. They're not common, they're not frequent occurrences, but these incredible, incomprehensible, inexpressible moments will provide you and I with the fuel for our journey and the motivation for our mission in life. We cannot afford to miss these rare and priceless invitations to meet God personally, powerfully, and purposefully. I'm going to take us to three different examples in Scripture this morning. And these examples and illustrations, I pray, will arm you with the information that's going to enable you to enjoy and to receive and make the most of these marvelous encounters and keep you from missing your God moment. The first text that I want to draw our attention to is the book of 1 Kings, chapter 19, and you can turn there, I'm not going to read it, but it's the account of Elijah, and in verses 9 through 18 of 1 Kings 19, there is a revelation that simply shows me that, listen to what I'm about to say, You are ripe for a visitation when you could care less if you had one. Amen? You are ripe for a God moment when you could care less if you had one. In 1 Kings 19, in these verses of 9 through 18, Elijah is not very excited at the prospects of ministry when all of a sudden God shows up. You see, he called fire down from heaven. He received word the next day as rain came and the prophets of Baal were slain, and he heard from Jezebel that she was going to have his hide, and he went on down to a juniper tree, sat under the tree and cried to die. But God never leaves you at the bottom of the barrel. He never leaves you without hope. God never allows you to stay where the devil wants to pin you down to. Amen? And the Bible said that God sent an angel to Elijah, and he brought him a meal, and he tapped him and said, come on out, it's time to eat. And he answered the dinner bell, and he ate, and the angel came back and said, I've got a second helping for you. Amen. And Elijah said, I'm hungry enough, I'll eat it. He had a second helping. The Bible said he went in the strength of that food and that meal and that impartation for the next 40 days and 40 nights. And he traveled up to the top of a mountain. He was energized enough that he could climb the mountain. He got to the top of the mountain, and then he began to hibernate in the cave. He's hanging out in the cave. He's just wanting to retreat from ministry and from people. And there are times when you've been through stressful situations, you just want to get away from it all. Elijah was in one of those moments in his life when all of a sudden his attention is arrested by a strong wind. And then there comes a fire, and then there comes an earthquake, but these magnificent displays of power did not contain neither the presence nor the purpose of God. It's as his senses are heightened that there comes a still small voice. And I want to tell you this morning that sometimes we miss God because our attention is misplaced. We're focused on the wrong manifestation. You see, Elijah had just witnessed God as he had sent fire down from heaven, and it was a violent storm that caused him to hurry off the hillside and get down off the mountain before a mudslide and a landslide took him out of the picture. These displays of God's power were fresh in his mind, and I think that perhaps we don't recognize God sometimes because we have a preconceived idea of who he is and how he works. You see, Elijah remembered the fire. Elijah remembered the violent storm. And now there comes a fire. And now there comes an earthquake. And now there comes a wind. Now there comes a violent storm. But God is not in the fire. God is not in the wind. And God is not in the earthquake. And sometimes we need God to get our attention because we're looking in the wrong direction. Toward the wonders, and we miss our wow moment. Touch your neighbor and say, wow. What's the wow moment? It's the wonder of a whisper moment. Amen. The wonder of the whisper. You see, the whisper meant more than the wonders because the whisper was personal. The wonders were public displays, but the whisper was for a private audience. Tell your neighbors, for your ears only. Hallelujah. And God doesn't waste his words. In Isaiah 30 and 21, it says, thou shalt hear a word behind thee saying, this is the way, walk ye in it when you turn to the right hand, and when you turn to the left. And Revelation 2, 7 said, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit would speak to the church. Amen. You see, with the arrival of social media, personal conversations are becoming a thing of the past, but God still believes in private talks. And I don't think it's all text, but I think he's got some good text if you want to read it. Amen. He's got a whole book, 66 books of texting. Hallelujah. You just got to find the text that he wants you to read for the moment you're in. Amen. But I believe that he not only wants you to read the text, I believe he wants you to hear the voice. I believe he wants you to listen. Sometimes I get a hankering to hear somebody on the phone, not read what they type on the computer.
Yes.
There's something about the inflection, the intonation, and the variation of our voice when we speak that begins to make clear the message we want to deliver than simply words in black and white. You see, God believes in those private talks. It was Samuel whose mother had said, if you give me a man child, I'll give him back to you all the days of my life. And next Sunday we're going to dedicate little Anne for me, and that's going to be a great time. But Hannah dedicated Samuel and sent him down to the temple as he got of age, and he began to learn from his teacher Eli. And one night as he was in the bedroom sleeping, he heard somebody call his name. And we know the story. He thought it was Eli as he heard the name Samuel. And Eli said, it wasn't me, Samuel. Go back to bed. It happened three times. And finally, on the third occasion, Eli said, that wasn't me, but I know who it was. You go back into your room, and I want you to know when you go back and you hear that voice this time, you say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. It was a private conversation that God wanted to have with Samuel. Eli wasn't even privy to it, although Eli was the authority. Amen. Sometimes God just wants to talk to you. But we get so caught up in what God's doing, we don't know what God's saying. Let me tell you, if you don't know what God's saying, you're never going to know what God's doing. We need to listen for that still, small voice. It was in the privacy of his bedroom that God gave Samuel revelation and called him to take a position that he was not ready for in the natural, but God had prepared him for in the spirit realm. It was Moses on the backside of a desert where nobody else was in sight, when the bush began to burn and be ablaze with the presence of a holy God. And as he drew near, Moses came close. The bush talked, and it was God speaking to Moses from that burning bush and calling him to deliver the Israelites out of a land of bondage. It was a private conversation. It was a personal word from God. I want to tell you, the visitations that God has with his people are very personal. They're very real. You know that God wants to get your attention for a reason. It was to Saul of Tarsus on that Damascus road that no one else heard what was being said. But he said, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And he said, who art thou, Lord? And God said, it's Jesus whom you persecute. Don't you know it's hard to kick against the pricks? And there he began to speak into Saul's life, changed his name, and he became Paul. It was in the cool of the day. It was when no one else was near because there was no one else around. It was only Adam and Eve. But it was in that setting, in the quietness and in the coolness of the evening hour, that God came down to walk and talk with Adam. But Adam was nowhere to be found, but he called his name and he said, I want to get your attention, son. You and I need to have a talk. We need to have a word. Amen. Hallelujah. We need to get some things ironed out. We need to get some issues settled. I want to speak to you. I need you to listen. I want your attention. Amen. And I want to tell you, God is waiting to speak to your heart today. And when you don't even want to hear from God, God will want to speak to you. Amen. Some of you, before you leave this place, are going to have a word ringing in your spirit that you are not going to be able to shake off. God is going to get a hold of you before you walk out of these doors. Don't you miss your God visitation. Don't you miss your God moment this morning. You see, Elijah's God moment was not only personal, it was inspirational. It inspired him. It motivated him. You see, a whisper, it may just be instructional or directional. In verses 15 and 16 of 1 Kings 19, the Bible said, "The Lord said unto him, unto Elijah, Go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi, shall thou appoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat, and
purpose, and if you aren't fulfilling purpose, you'll find out sitting in a cave.
satisfy. You're going to find out you were created to do something. You were created for a reason. And Elijah was not going to be content. I'll tell you one thing about ministry. There are seasons in ministry where you just want to take a sabbatical. There are times you want to leave the ministry. The problem is, after you haven't been in the ministry for a month or two or three, or for some of us an hour or two, it doesn't take long and you miss it. You say, I'd like to quit this thing, I'd like to get out of here, but you know you can't, because if you did, you'd be frustrated that you weren't back doing what you were supposed to be doing. That's the way it is in life. When you know you have a purpose and you're not fulfilling it, you are going to live in frustration, agitation, irritation. You're not going to be satisfied. And here is Elijah hiding out in the cave. Yeah, he needed a little space, he needed a little time, but God said, you've had enough time, son, and now I'm going to reveal myself to you. Don't miss your God moment. Don't miss it. Don't get so caught up in the wind, the fire, the earthquake. Don't misplace your attention. Don't get caught up in the wonders. Listen for my voice. God wants to speak to somebody today. We turn now to the book of Acts, chapter 1 and chapter 2. We come to our second example. We come to our second illustration in Acts 1 and verse 14. The Bible said these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. And then verses 1 through 4 of chapter 2. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. You see, the first God moment was a wow moment. It was the wonder of a whisper. The next God moment that we're going to examine doesn't take place in a still small voice in a private setting. But this God moment that we're going to examine takes place in an atmosphere of expectation. The 120 were gathered in an upper room and they were praying while others were playing. Amen? They were intentional. Jeremiah tells me in the 13th verse of the 29th chapter, and you will search for me and you will find me when you seek for me with all your heart. Amen? They were going after God. You see, Elijah wasn't going after God. He was just hanging out. He could care less if he had a God encounter. But the 120 in the upper room were searching for a God encounter. They had been given a promise that they would be endued with power from on high. And they wanted what God assured them was theirs. Sometimes you have to pursue what you want to possess. Sometimes you have to seek the person you wish to find. How many of you men chased your wife until she caught you?
Amen.
Sometimes you gotta go after God. Woo-hoo. Sometimes you can't sit back and hope he shows up. I think a lot of us like the Elijah kind of God moment, where we're not doing anything and he just knocks on our door. But it takes a little more effort to have the 120 kind of God moment, when you have to chase him down, find him, seek him, search for him, track him down. You have to go after him with all your heart. And when you do, he said, when you seek me, you're going to find me. This God moment, unlike Elijah's, was not so personal as much as it was powerful. Acts 1:8 says, you receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you'll be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem and all Judea and in Samaria and under the uttermost part of the earth. The disciples had separated themselves for the specific purpose of what? Waiting on God. Isaiah 40:31 said, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And as they gathered to wait on God, suddenly there comes something this morning. This was an explosive arrival of God, a visitation of divinity in the person of the Holy Ghost. This was not a wow moment. This was a pop moment. Everybody, you turn to your neighbor and say, pop. Wow. You see, wow is the wonder of a whisper. But the pop moment is the power of His presence. How many want the power of His presence today? Amen? Some of us like the calmness of the wonder of a whisper. Others want the pop of the power of His presence. It's explosive. It's anointed. It is God coming down in glory. Acts 4:31 said, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word of God with boldness. You see, in this instance, Jesus had just ascended, and the disciples recognized they needed help from on high to continue the assignment they had been given. Jacob had a God moment that was so powerful and intense that it changed his name, it changed his walk, and it changed his destiny. Some of us need a God moment that will change our lives. This God moment was not inspirational. This God moment was impartational. And I made that word up. Amen? It wasn't inspirational, it was impartational. Luke 24:49 says, tarry, Jesus said to the disciples, tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. Amen? That word endued in the Greek means sinking into. Amen? Seeping into, endued. Amen? Invested in, clothed with. Amen? Tarry in Jerusalem until you have something poured in you. There are times when God just wants to pour something into you so that He can get something out of you. Whenever you make an investment, you want a return. Amen? If you don't want a return, why invest? But God invests in you so He can get something back out of you. Acts 2, where the Holy Ghost is poured in, is followed by Acts 3, where Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I just got it. It was the impartation of the Holy Ghost, and He poured it into me in chapter 2 so He could bring it out of me in chapter 3. Silver and gold I have none, but such as I have I give unto you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up on your feet and walk. How many want to be able to do something for God? If you're ever going to do something for God, God has to do something in you. Oh, I want one of those moments where God not only gets my attention and he gets my whole focus, and He's personal and He's inspirational and He inspires me to do something, but I want those times where His power comes down and He begins to pour something into me, and He begins to fill my emptiness, and He begins to make up for my lack, and He begins to supply what I don't have and what I need. I thank God for these kind of God moments. It was in prayer that Peter fell into a trance, and he had one of those God moments. And God gave him a vision of a sheep coming down from heaven with all manner of four-footed creatures and all kinds of animals that were in his thoughts and his instruction under the law unclean. And God said, arise, kill and eat. And Peter said, I can't. That's unclean. It's common. And God said, what I've cleansed, don't you call common? He said, I've got a job for you to do. And there He began to pour something into Peter because He wanted to get something out of Peter. He began to pour in a little bit of vision because He wanted to get out a whole lot of ministry. Amen. He wanted to take him to the Gentiles where Peter never would have gone if he didn't have a God moment of a powerful kind when he has this divine revelation that knocked his socks off. I like those kind of God moments where God just comes down. And I want to tell you, the God moments I'm talking about are few and far between. I've had several God moments in my life, but there's one that eclipses every other God moment I've had, and that was at the age of 10, and you've heard me share this before. But as I was in a sawdust camp meeting, I was face down laying at that altar. There were a lot of people all around me, but I didn't know who was there. I couldn't tell you how many. I know the altar was packed that night, but all I know is I was over on your left, and if I'm looking out on the right side of that pulpit in that old tabernacle at Mountain View Gospel Camp. And I laid right in front of the first row of seats. I wasn't even up to near the pulpit. I was right in front of those seats. And I can take you right there. I was laid in kind of this position. I wasn't perpendicular, and I wasn't directly facing. I was angled. I can take you to that spot. It is etched in my memory and in my mind. It was so real and so incredible. And as I lay there, and tears are streaming down my face, then I've come to commit my life to Jesus Christ. And all of a sudden, he gets personal with me, and he begins to inspire me, because he starts talking to me as I give my life to him. And he starts laying out the call on my life, and he starts to give me inspiration that I need to get up and do something, like he had to get Elijah to get up and do something. And not only was it personal and inspirational, it was powerful and impartational, because at that very moment, he baptized me with the Holy Ghost and fire, and I began to speak with other tongues, and it was a life-transforming event that I will never forget. Those kind of God moments, you don't want to miss them, church. You don't want to miss those times when God begins to arrest your attention and captivate you and not let you go until he gets the message through that he wants you to receive. When was the last time you had a God moment like that? I'm not talking about a good feel-good time. I'm not talking about a time where you left a little bit, ooh, glory. I'm talking about a God moment. See, most churches don't even understand. Most Christians don't even understand. Most people don't even understand what I'm talking about when I'm talking about a God moment, when God actually gets into your business. When God begins to show up where you're at, when God begins to let you know he's real and alive, it's not religion, it's relationship. Oh, if you're satisfied with coming to church and hearing some poor preacher get up there and sermonize and summarize, then good for you, but I want life. I want Jesus. I want purpose. I don't want to go through the motions. I want something to change me, rearrange me, get a hold of me, and turn me right side up. Oh, hallelujah, glory to Jesus. My call was both personal and powerful, inspirational and impartational. Let's move to our third illustration. Let's go to the book of Luke, chapter 2. And in Luke chapter number 2, we read the story of the shepherds on a hillside. And in verse number 8 of the second chapter of the Gospel of Luke, and there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. You can read the rest of it later. I'm just going to stop right there. You see, the 120 were playing while others were praying, but the shepherds were watching while others were sleeping. Amen? They were keeping watch over their flock by night. They were watching while others were sleeping. This was not a wow moment. This was not a pop moment. This was an awe moment. Awe. Arrival of heavenly hosts. Hallelujah. How many want an awe moment today? How many want the glory of God to come down? How many want the angelic host to show up? How many want God to arrest your attention in such a magnificent way? It may be the wonder. It may be the power of his presence. And it may be the arrival of the heavenly host. Wow. Pop! Oh, I want that kind of an experience with God today. It'll just shake you up. It'll stir you. It'll change. It'll rock your world. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You see, this God moment was not only personal and powerful, This final God moment was purposeful. The birth of Christ was the culmination of many years of a prophetic promise which was finally being fulfilled. And I don't believe that the shepherds were randomly selected. I believe God deliberately showed up where they were when no one else was around. See, there's one final God moment that you cannot afford to miss. In Revelation 3 and verse 3, Jesus said, "Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee." If you're not watching, you're going to miss it. The rapture is not going to be random selection. Amen. That's a God moment you cannot afford to miss. When Jesus breaks through the clouds at the sound of the trumpet and the voice of the archangel, and he said, "Hey, come on home." Oh, glory to God. Oh, this God moment is not only inspirational, impartational, but this God moment is revelational. And that's another word I made up. No such word is revelational any more than impartational, but I thought they were neat words. Whenever my wife and I play Scrabble, and Mary, you know, you're a Scrabble player, she makes up these words. I'm telling on her now, she makes up words. And then when we go look it up on Google, it's a Scrabble word. What is a Scrabble word? Use it in a sentence. I don't get this Scrabble words. How are Scrabble words different from Webster words? But it works. She wins. Hallelujah. So I'm making up words today, but it's all right. If she can make them up, I can make them up, because we're one flesh. So it's impartational and it's revelational. Amen. Hallelujah. How many know there are times that God not only wants to just talk to you and pour something into you, but there's sometimes God just wants to show you something. He just wants to reveal something. Remember Thomas? He said, "I won't believe unless I experience and see for myself." And what happened? Jesus showed up and he gave him a revelation. He said, "Go ahead, son. Touch. Thrust your hand in my side and put your fingers in the palms and go ahead and experience me. I want you to know I'm God. I need to reveal myself to you." John on the Isle of Patmos. Wow, I was thinking of this morning. The older you get, the longer you've been in ministry, and you know that you have more years behind you than you have ahead of you. Now John has been exiled to the Isle of Patmos, and it looks like ministry is over. But it ain't over till it's over. And there alone, isolated on a treeless island that is uninhabited, just a piece of rock, he has a call. It's personal because no one else is on the island. It's inspirational because it inspires him to write the last book of the Bible. It is powerful because he said, when I got a glimpse of him whose hair is white as snow, as white as wool, it was so powerful I fell on the earth. I fell at his feet as if dead. I saw him whose eyes were flaming fire, his feet were finely polished brass, and out of his mouth went a two-edged sword, and I just collapsed. It was so awesome. It was so incredible. And it was so inspirational, impartational. It poured something into me. What it poured into John that day, it poured into him hope for the future and hope for eternity. As he'd been isolated and alone and left to die by himself, he was inspired to know, and he was imparted with a vision, and he had a fresh touch of God. But not only was it personal and powerful, inspirational and impartational, it was purposeful and it was revelational, because in that moment he saw the New Jerusalem coming down from God in heaven, adorned like a bride for the bridegroom. And he began to write, and he began to minister. In his final moments on this earth, God gave him a God moment. Zacchaeus had a God moment as he heard about Jesus, and he went looking for him. And he couldn't see him because he was short and the people had gathered around. But as he climbed up in the tree, it was in that instant that as Zacchaeus went looking for Jesus, that Jesus revealed himself to Zacchaeus and went to his house and began to make himself known. God wants to reveal something to you today if you'll let him. God wants to show you something if you'll let him. In the book of Hebrews chapter 9, and verse number 28, the Bible said, "So Christ once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him," to those who what? "Look for him, shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation." The shepherds were watching while others were sleeping. If you are watching for him, you will find him. If you are looking for him, but if you're not looking for his appearing, you're going to miss out. And you can't afford to miss the final God moment. "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, the trump of God. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord." That's the kind of God moment you can't afford mess up. The prophetic word that Nolan gave talked about the 10 virgins. There were 5 wise and there were 5 foolish. 5 were ready and 5 weren't. 5 were watching and 5 weren't. And 5 missed their God moment. And 5 made it through. The Bible said that in that last day, 2 will be working in the field. The one is going to have a God moment, and the other's going to miss the God moment. 2 will be grinding at the mill. One is going to experience the God moment, and one is going to miss the God moment. You see, you can't afford to miss that final God moment that there is when he begins to reveal himself in the clouds of glory. Jesus, who we have never seen with the eye, is going to appear. Hallelujah. This same Jesus, which you have seen go into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go. Hallelujah. This is not a different Jesus. This is not a God impersonator. It's not a Jesus lookalike. This is the one that promised he'd come again. This is the one that calmed the raging sea. This is the one that turned the water into wine. This is the one that brought Lazarus out of the grave. This is the same one that conquered death and hell, and the empty tomb was his proof of life. And I want you to know, you cannot afford to miss when he comes again. Amen. We're not living in the last days. We are living in the last hours. Don't miss your God moment. I close and I say this. I can't think of anything worse than missing out on a God moment. Nothing can replace a visitation from the great I Am. It may come when you could care less. It may come when you're actively seeking. Or it may come when you're simply waiting and watching. But regardless of when it comes, when it does come, it will change your life. I want to ask you a question today. Have you ever had, truly had, a God moment? So many people wander through life and they don't even
with you.
They never had a God moment, because when God shows up, he gives you purpose, he gives you power, and he gives person. You see, a lot of people don't know what life offers because they've never met the giver of life. These kind of God moments that I'm talking about are not run-of-the-mill, everyday experiences. They're not just the anointing comes into the service and you feel goosebumps. That's not the God moment I'm talking about. I'm talking about a God moment that is like no other moment you've ever had. And you will never forget it when it takes place. You won't be able to erase it from your